Hi everyone, this is Pierrick from P2design. So you got into animation, you learned a few principles, and then you hit spline and it doesn't look as good as you were expecting. Here are a few tips that will put you on the right track to learn animation. I will be using Blender as usual, but this applies to any software. Let's get started. The first tip is to consolidate your poses. Here's the blocking of the beginning of an animation I did a few weeks ago. The blocking feels good, but as soon as I switch to spline, it's all floaty. Especially this part where the character is transitioning into the anticipation before the jumping knee. And I had the same problem here. The blocking feels good, but when I switch to spline, the animation lacks impact and feels sloppy. And this is something I see a lot on beginner's animations. And this is exactly the same problem you will have when modeling. You have a nice cube with sharp edges, you want to subdivide it to give it a more polished look, and now you lose the whole shape and the cube looks too smooth. And what you will do to fix that is to use supporting edges. It's basically an edge that supports another edge before a drastic change in direction. The same concept applies with 3D animation. If we compare these to blocking, you can hardly see the difference. But if I now switch to spline and you compare the left animation with the right animation, when the character transitions into the anticipation pose, the animation on the right feels way snappier and impactful. Here is my base blocking. During the blocking stage, the transition feels okay. But when I switch to spline, Blender will interpolate between those two poses and I don't want that. Now if I switch to the blocking where I fixed the problem, you can see that I've added a pose that is almost similar to the pose on frame 9. I just pushed it a bit so that it supports the pose on frame 9 before transitioning onto the pose on frame 16. And when switching to spline, I kept this very snappy transition. So this is what you could call a supporting frame or supporting pose. Speaking of poses, you need to block solid anticipations. You should consider them as part of your key poses. Starting with the base pose, when I see those two additional poses, I do understand that my character is preparing something. He's loading energy before the release. Then we have the next pose that is the result of this anticipation, what our character was aiming for. Then we need to know where it's going to land. And then I transition into another anticipation, because I know he's preparing another shot after that. So with these few poses, I do understand my character moves, and this is what you have to aim for when posing your character. The Art of Posing is one of the chapters from my animation course Alive, available on p2designacademy.com. You can also find there top-rated character creation and rigging courses in Blender. In the meantime, here are a few posing tips. First of all, and this is something you've heard so many times, but you should use references. So I won't bother you that much with that. But there is one essential thing you need to ask yourself whenever you're creating a pose. Is this pose possible? I'm sure you faced this problem before or saw it onto a character pose. And this is also a common rigging problem where people try to rotate the arm this way, and it looks bad, and they try to fix it with weight painting while there is no issue. Or there's one, in the pose, not in the rig. You can't raise an arm like this without rotating the shoulder. As soon as the arm reaches an angle that is close to 90 degrees, you need to raise the shoulder. Another mechanism that is sometimes broken, knees and elbows only rotate or almost only rotate around one axis. And this pose is painful to look at. So when exploring the rig, try to identify the main rotation channel or axis for the knee and the elbows. And when it comes to the hand where you have much freedom, try to pose your own hand and see if it matches on your character. Not a big deal, but the shoulder line and respecting the joint limitation is super important. It's the same for the leg, you can't achieve this pose. You have to compensate with the whole spine. It's not the best pose I ever did, but making sure that the legs are within a 180 degrees angle with the hips. Because in real life, you can't really go beyond this limit. Another common mistake is to forget that knees are aligned with the feet. So don't forget to tweak and adjust your pull targets on your leg's inverse kinematic mechanism. And my final advice regarding posing is that while the spine has a broad range of rotation, it doesn't twist that much. So be cautious with the range of twisting you give to your spine. And you should favorize the use of the torso root for the torso orientation, and then add a little bit of twisting using the chest and hips controller. The next tip, or rather tool, you should learn is the beginner's nemesis, the graph editor. What I advise you is to go through simple exercises like this bouncing cube, for example. It's the same principle as the bouncing ball, but I'm using a simple cube. The idea here is to make the cube bounce by only using the graph editor. Your goal is not to master the graph editor, but just to understand curve behavior. When something is impacting, for example, I should have a broken curve profile. You don't want your curve to ease before an impact, for example. So just tackle the graph editor with very simple exercises like this one. And while the graph editor is an important tool, you don't necessarily need it. Don't overthink the graph editor or reading the curves. I do use the graph editor for the root of my character and the feet, but very often I don't use it at all for the other part of the character, for my arm rotation, the shoulder rotation, and so on. I'm not saying that I never use it, but I do rely on another tool. The motion path is, in my humble opinion, the most important tool for any animator, because it shows you the actual result of your animation in the 3D space or on your screen. The graph editor does that, but in a more abstract way, or with something you have to interpret. While the motion path tells you, okay, this controller is in this position on this frame. And with that, you can control the spacing of your animation, whether an object is accelerating, easing, damping, if it's moving fast or slow, and it's your best friend whenever it comes to tracking your arcs. You don't need the graph editor to work on your arcs, but you do need the motion path. Look how my path is smooth, like everything is connected and it draws a nice curve. You can do that by adjusting your character position into space, and you should track every point of your character. The elbows, the knees, the feet, the wrists, and you want to look for any jittering shape onto your motion path, and then you can fix it by hand. You don't necessarily need to go into the graph editor to do so. When it comes to arm rotation with the connection to the shoulders, there is a lot involved into it. Yes, you can use the graph editor to fix those poses, but you can also do it by hand directly on screen. That's not a problem. The problem in your animation is when you have bad poses, bad arcs, and bad spacing. And the motion path is your best friend for spacing and arcs. The wider the space between two points on the motion path, the faster the tracked feature is moving. And this brings us to the last tip: understand spacing. There are a lot of different words or expression or a lot of vocabulary related to acceleration or spacing. You don't need to know all the words, you need to understand the result visually. But if you're interested, you may want to have a look to this video I released a few months ago. So back to our interpolations. So on the first line, I have a linear interpolation. So the spacing is even between each frames, and it looks very robotic. On the second cube, we can see it accelerating or easing in at the beginning, and then slowing down or easing out at the end. And this is the kind of motion you should look for most of your character features. Now, if you want to bring more impact, you can use a faster motion and a slight overshoot, where the character features or the cube go beyond the final position and then settle back. That's great for a punch, for example. Now, if you're working on an impact or a contact, then just don't slow down before you hit the wall. And then you can add a little bounce or whatever. And this will show on the motion path. whether it's for an object or a bone, you can calculate the motion path, give it the color you want for better readability, and read the spacing. Good posing, good spacing, and good arcs are the very fundamentals to get better animations. It won't replace a good story, but as an animator, those are the first fundamentals you need to have. This is the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you in the next one.